Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Congressman Drew Ferguson, an executive vice president and chief marketing officer of Norfolk Southern and vice chair of the Georgia Chamber. Ed Elkins.
Congressman.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone.
Thank you so much for taking time to spend with us today. You know, I was looking at your career. It's congressman, doctor, mayor, businessman, and I had a big debate with my wife last night. What should I call you? You know, is it Dr. Congressman or is it Congressman Mayor? You've had a tremendous career. Four terms in the Congress. House Ways and Means Committee, Chief Deputy Whip. It's an amazing career, and given what Amy was talking about earlier, an amazing time right now. Everyone at the chamber was sad to hear about your retirement, quite frankly, because you've been a friend of the chamber and friend of business in Georgia since the first day you got to Congress. And I'll say, personally, after getting to know you a little bit, I'm very sad that you're leaving now. So we thought we would take this time, maybe if you're willing to just do kind of an exit interview and talk about what you learned and give us some of your insight and wisdom and perhaps maybe give us some guidance on where maybe we can go from here. How's that sound?
That sounds great.
Very good. You know, the first and most obvious question that I wanted to ask you is, you know, what do you view as your greatest accomplishment that you had while you were up in Washington?
Surviving with my sanity. This has been the honor of a lifetime to serve the 3rd Congressional District, but also this great state of Georgia in Congress. And we've been able to hit some really high marks in a very short period of time. And it's all been done on the focus of making sure that we serve our district and serve this great state. And when I look back on it, the things that that we've been a part of and have had an impact in are things that really have helped, in many cases, so many of our fellow Georgians lead better lives. I go back to the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act of 2017 and look at the tremendous work that was done there to revitalize an economy and make America the most competitive place in the world to do business. And Georgia has been able to tap into that success. And again, for 10 years in a row, this has been the best state in the nation for doing business. Trade deals, the USMCA deal that replaced NAFTA has been a significant improvement for Georgia businesses. And it's created an environment where we've seen really enormous growth. And then I look at it and then I think to myself, what are the things that I've enjoyed and been really a part of? Being in House leadership and understanding the dynamics of the conference and how it shifted. I think when I look at Congress right now, about 64% of just the House Republican Conference is new since 2017. It's a pretty remarkable turnover and very different, very dynamic group of people that are there in the House now. So, you know, being a part of the House leadership team was a real honor and something exciting, but really being able to focus on the things that we went to Washington to do, which is to make America the most competitive place in the world to do business, those things have had an impact and been a lot of fun to be a part of.
Well, I think it's working. You know, as speaking as someone that's in the business community, I travel around the world and talk to lots of different folks who are looking to invest in different places, and the U.S. is head and shoulders above any other place in the world. I'm proud of everything you've done up there. I really have. Is there anything that you think is that you'd like to spend more time on if you weren't retiring? Is there something that you wish you could push across the finish line?
Well, I would look ahead to 2025 and think about the fact that there's about to be $4.6 trillion worth of tax policy on the table. Many of the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act provisions expire in 2025, and that is going to be a monumental shift in how Congress addresses this, particularly if we are in divided government. There's Every one of your businesses has a tax issue that you're going to have to deal with next year. Can't tell you what it is just yet, but I promise you that you are going to be facing a challenging tax environment. But being able to be a part of that, using whatever tools are there to address not only the tax code, but the budget deficits, being a part of rewriting the budget rules, which is something that I think is going to happen. All of those things are things that in some regards I wish I could be a part of, but I think we'll find ways to be engaged. And let me say this, I've found, to me, the most fascinating thing that has happened to members of Congress is that they're not feeling it yet, but that is the overturning of the Chevron doctrine a few weeks ago with the Supreme Court. It's going to make matters, it's going to make members of Congress matter even more, because now in the court system they're going to defer to Congress's intent, not the administration. That's going to be an incredible opportunity for members of Congress to have real impact on legislation.
That's a really good point. And I think it's going to play out over years, maybe, to see see how that goes. Are there what were the big surprises when you first came to Washington? I can't imagine, as an outsider looking in, what it was like to show up, and what surprised you the most?
Learning how different our country is based off a geographic region. Folks in the Northeast are just very different and view things differently than folks in the Southeast. Mm-hmm. And folks in the Southeastern Conference just are vastly different than our friends and fellow citizens out on the left coast. And you take Washington, Oregon, and California and lay that over the heartland of America, it just doesn't fit. And so learning how diverse our country is based off a geographic region. I may be closer to a Southern Democrat on an issue than I may be a Northeastern Republican on an issue. And so learning that, and then learning, quite candidly, just how to sift through the noise and stay focused on the main mission, which is representing your congressional district.
You know, you said something to me earlier. We were talking, and it was about jobs, about what the common person wants, and it really resonated with me. Could you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I think we spend a lot of time, and we have for way too many years, focusing on our differences. And I learned this as a mayor. If you really talk to people in your communities, the things that we all want are a job where we can provide for our families. We want a decent, safe place to come home to at the end of a long day's work. We want an education for our children that prepares them to do better than we did. And we want the freedom to be who we want to be in this great country. So think of it as a job, a decent home, a great education for your kid, and the freedom to be who you want to in this great nation of ours. If we can keep the focus on those four things, we've got a chance to move the country forward. And at the core of that, now what I think is so important, what I think is so important for this state, is don't get complacent on job creation. If we are growing jobs in this state, and if we're growing jobs in this country, then we have a chance to address every other issue that we want to get engaged with. But if we aren't growing jobs and the numbers of jobs, then we are really going to struggle as a state and as a nation to be competitive and to meet some very serious obligations that we have with Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, many of the entitlement programs, taking care of our men and women that have served this country. If we don't have the resources and we aren't the most competitive place in the world to do business, and this state is not the most competitive state in the country to do business, we're going to start to slip. And the pain that we'll feel from that is going to be real on our families. So we have to keep the main thing, which is creating jobs and continuing to grow the economy and then using that activity to make our lives better.
That's fantastic. And I really appreciate that you said you learned it when you were a mayor. And I think you also said that there are a few other mayors in Washington that you kind of affiliate with and seem to get along with. I really hope that there's more of that perspective out there. I think it's really important that people understand and that our representatives do the same. You know, when I look at maybe all of us, when we look at Washington, it seemed like a pretty raucous place, pretty polarizing place. You know, it's hard to watch the news sometimes. And now that you've seen it, what do you feel like that we can do, and what should the country be doing to try to move back toward a more bipartisan state, so to speak?
I think we're going to have to get back to focusing again on those things that we all need, and how do we get to that? How do we get the best jobs? How do we get to a place that we're having safety and security in our homes and our neighborhoods? How are we making sure that the education system is preparing our children, and what role do parents have in doing that, preparing them for a brighter future? And then I think at some point, I really do feel strongly about this. Americans, more than anything else, want to be left alone to achieve and to believe and to love and to think how they want to think. I think if we can keep that the focus on that, we begin to build a pathway forward. I really think that we're going to continue to go through a pretty major shift in the political parties. I look at where I grew up in West Point, Georgia. I look at that part of the state, and it wasn't that long ago that every single elected official in that area was a Democrat. And the only red that you could find in this state was in Metro Atlanta, and of all places, Athens, Georgia. Now that has flipped, okay? Where we are is deep red, and the blue is Metro Atlanta and Athens, Georgia. There's other spots around, but you get the sense of it. So what's really changed? It's really only the party that claims to represent me. And as our speaker noted today, you have a lot of people that used to be Democrats that are now voting Republican, tend to be more working class, entrepreneurs, small business folks, and it's a very diverse background. And a lot of the folks that used to vote Republican are now voting Democrat that tend to be in the suburbs. So I think that shift is going to continue to go on. I think that if you look at the House and Senate, those margins are going to be very, very tight for the next decade. No matter who's at the top of the ticket. And redistricting has led us to a point where there really, truly only are about two dozen competitive districts around the country. And I think whichever party can figure out how to build a coalition in the middle around those things that we all desire, I think that's the group that wins out for the next decade.
Mm. We were also talking earlier, and you were giving me some insight into the House Ways and Means Committee and, yeah, and how complex some of the issues are that you're dealing with. And I'll be frank, I had no appreciation for, how much drinking from a fire hose you have to do, so to speak, to be successful. Can you talk about that a little bit and about, what your experience has told you is important in terms of what the main thing is when you're on those committees?
And so when you get to Congress, you're supposed to be an expert on everything on day one. And I'll tell you a quick story. I was a high school senior, and I was working for a cousin of mine who's more like an uncle, his Marine dealership, and I was giving him an earful one day as an 18-year-old, and he looked at me and he said, the smartest person in the world is a high school senior, and the dumbest is a college freshman, and then but 24 hours separate the two of you. Fast forward, the smartest person in the world is somebody running for Congress because we got all the answers, and the dumbest is the one that just got sworn in. So there is a fairly steep learning curve, and you've got to be really engaged, and you have to have a desire to learn and to be a good committee member and to become an expert. It's almost like getting a master's degree in something new every year that you're there. But the good news is that if you're a good teammate, folks will help you get there, and if you keep the main thing, which for me has always been about growing jobs and making sure that our economy is sound, the resources are there to help you do that.
Very good. I get the sense, and I don't believe that you're retiring per se. Maybe you're just starting a new career at some point. And I'm excited to see where you go. Can you talk to us about what you're thinking in terms of, what are you going to do next?
Well, I'm very blessed to have my wife Julie here with me today, and we're figuring that out right now. A couple of things that I've learned through this experience: I like Georgia a whole lot more than I like Washington, D.C. And it was time for us to point our compass south and come back home to the state and see how we can be helpful back here in the great state of Georgia.
That's awesome. That's great. I can't wait to learn more about it. A lot of business people here. You're a business person, along with everything else that you've accomplished. Any thoughts on what we could be doing to help move the country forward when you think about business in Georgia in particular?
Yeah, I can't emphasize enough how important it is to be focused on the changes that are going to be coming in the tax code next year. This is going to be, I'll say it again, $4.6 trillion worth of tax policy is on the table. There are no sacred cows, and the Congress has changed so much. Put this, if everybody wins re-election that's running for Congress this time, there will only be 86 members on the Republican side that voted on the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act. Think about that for just a minute. So we're going into the largest rewrite of a tax code with the least amount of experience and institutional knowledge. And the numbers are very similar for my colleagues on the other side of the aisle as well. So I think being on your toes, being focused, getting information, and really being an advocate for your entity in that tax reform conversation is going to be the thing that we need to do to keep America moving forward. We simply cannot sit back and rest and let the rest of the world catch up to us. We should be focusing on how do we continue to grow our economy, and by growing our economy, it's about growing jobs.
Very good. Was there anything, and I, again, on the exit interview theme here, was there anything that you felt like you could have done better? Would you rate yourself, low on any given topic or category?
The list of things I could have done better on is probably long and distinguished. I look at it from the standpoint that, I went from being a practicing dentist and a small town mayor to doing that, and I know that it was the honor of a lifetime to serve this great state and serve the third district. And I think, going back to one question you asked about what can you do, I think we have to make sure that our representatives know that their primary responsibility is to stay focused on their districts, mm-hmm. and on their states. I get a sense right now that we've got way too many national congressmen and congressmen and women out there that are tapping into a lot of emotion on Twitter and different types of social media. But at the core of it, it's about taking care of your district, and it's about focusing on this great state of Georgia. And those are the things we need more than anything else right now.
That's fantastic. Look, last question.
Yeah.
Maybe the easiest one, maybe the hardest one. Did you ever think you'd end up where you are right now?
No, this is not something we set out to do, not something that I really meant to do. It's where we are, and the good Lord has blessed us with a lot of opportunities and enthusiasm and energy. And the thing that I've seen out of it more than anything else is I'm reminded again just what a fantastic state we have. I get to compare Georgia against 49 other states every single day when I'm in D.C., and there is absolutely no better state to live in, to work in, to start a business in, and to grow a business than our state of Georgia. And that perspective is invaluable to me.
That's wonderful. Well, look, on behalf of the chamber, on behalf of everyone here, thank you for your service.
Thank you.
It's been an honor.
Thank you.